Good afternoon to all of you in America. Bonsoir to our friends in France. What's going on, folks? It's time for another LNB Pro A Game of the Week featuring Zaccharie Risacher and Bourg-en-Bresse taking on Roanne. I'm Kevin Dano alongside Strong Jaw himself, Kyle Boone, a CBS Sports NBA mock draft prognosticator. And Kyle, great to be back doing games with you as we take a look at Zaccharie Risacher, who you have going number one on your board.
Yeah, good afternoon, Kevin. I'm glad to watch this game with you. Been watching some Risacher for a little while now. Been very busy with March Madness, but this is an exciting time, I think, for NBA prospects in the 2024 class. We're kind of in the stretch run here where, you know, guys are going to start separating themselves kind of as we get towards the kind of stretch run here leading up to the summer months for the NBA draft. And Risacher is absolutely going to be in the mix as the number one prospect in this class. It's a wide open class. Risacher has kind of all the tools. He's producing at a high level. And obviously, as we saw last year, if you can produce at a high level in the Pro A, NBA teams are going to take notice of what you can do.
That they are. He's not putting up Wemby-like numbers, but still 11 points, 3 rebounds, and well above 40% from three on the season, currently at 44% when you include Euro Cup and LNB Pro A games combined. Quite the start, as we got a 3-3 ball game. Sekou Doumbouya heading a 3 for Roanne, former first-round draft choice of the Detroit Pistons. It looks like Risacher will be coming off the bench in this game as Isaiah Mike jams it down. But how many, if obviously last year, 2023, it was a slam dunk who was going to go number one, and two and three were pretty locked up in some form of Scoot Henderson and Brandon Miller, eventually Brandon going second, Scoot going third. But it feels like it's a lot more wide open at the top. How many different guys do you think have a case to go number one overall this year?
Yeah, it is totally wide open this year. It's a very fun class. Risacher is going to be in the mix to go number one, but he is certainly one of, I would say, six, maybe seven players who realistically could be in the mix to be that top overall pick in this year's class. Alex Saar, I think, could be in the mix. Rob Dillingham from Kentucky could be in the mix. It wouldn't be surprised if Reed Shepard from Kentucky, Dillingham's teammate, also in the mix. You've got Cody Williams from Colorado. Ron Holland has fallen off a little bit, but I think was still clearly a kind of a top 10 prospect in this class. It's a lot of fun. I mean, last year it was nice because it takes some of the drama out of it leading up to the NBA draft. You know, it's going to be Victor Wembanyama and then everyone else. This year is absolutely not the case. I've done, I think, 3 different mock drafts already this year, Kevin. And I've already had 3 different guys at the number one spot. I think actually my last one, Rob Dillingham from Kentucky was the number one in my mock draft. It's totally wide open. It's totally wide. Sam Vecini, who works for The Athletic, does a really good job covering the NBA draft. Has him number one overall right now, and I really follow and respect Vecini's point of view. His evaluations are usually really spot on. But he admits, like, it's a wide open class. You know, there's some concern about Risacher in terms of can he be a good, reliable shot creator yet? But physical tools for someone who's only 18 years old, you know, the value that you get in like huge wings and the value that they bring to the NBA right now, he checks a lot of boxes in terms of maybe what he could be in a few years.
Yeah, he basically has been a spot-up shooter for Bourg-en-Bresse this year, and he's done that at a very high clip. Again, 44% from three. We've played 3 minutes in this one, tied at 7, still waiting for our first Risacher appearance as Isaiah Mike gets fouled. But do you think Bourg using him as a spot-up shooter, while Asvel, when he played with Asvel, the games I saw in him in Asvel last year, he had the ball in his hands a little bit more. Then you see Risacher's number 10 sitting on the bench behind Frédéric Fatoux, the head coach of Bourg-en-Bresse. Do you think him being kind of used in just kind of a specific role with Bourg this year has helped or hurt his draft stock?
No, I think it's definitely helped. His draft stock has kind of been on a roller coaster really for the last year, Kevin. He came to play at the Hoop Summit last year. Was good, but maybe not great, and maybe not as impressive as people had hoped and anticipated. And so I think that hurt him. He had to kind of work himself back. He goes from Asvel to Bourg and Bresse and has, I think, done a nice job here kind of recouping his draft stock, not only recovering from maybe what people thought he would be, but maybe showing some flashes of maybe what people didn't expect from him as well. He's not the focal point of this team. I think that's a good thing for his development. He's really thrived as kind of a spot-up shooter, and I think that's where his game right now is best. He's a really good defensive prospect. He's long. He's very versatile. He's not a guy who, you know, right now at this point, again, not really a shot creator, not someone who's going to run your offense. But, you know, again, you're projecting as an NBA team, if you're picking at number one, you're projecting what a guy can be in 3, 4, 5 years, not what he can be, you know, in 2024.
Well, it's 11-9, Sekou Doumbouya for three. That's his second three of the game. Doumbouya, the former Detroit Piston and L.A. Laker with 3 years of NBA experience. He's played, this is just his fourth game with Roanne, but he's been balling at 21.3 points per game as Jaquan Lewis puts Bourg en Bresse back on top, 13-12. So Risacher hasn't played in this game yet. He has struggled a little bit in recent games. In the Euro Cup quarterfinals, Risacher with just 3 points all at the line went 0-7 from the field. And in the matchup against Tijan Salah and Cholet, which unfortunately we were unable to bring you on the NBA app due to some technical issues, Risacher 10 points, 4 rebounds, but it came on 4 of 12 shooting. So you wonder perhaps if that has a little bit with him has a little bit to do with him coming off the bench. This will be his 11th game off the bench in 44 appearances, as that's tapped up and in.
Yeah, momentum is a huge thing, Kevin. I mean, when you get into a groove, when you're playing with a lot of confidence, and then you're coming off the bench, it's difficult to establish yourself. And so it's interesting to kind of see how Risacher does here today. Struggled a little bit. This has been, you know, in totality, a really good season for him. The sky is certainly the limit. The arrow is pointing up for him. His shooting, I think, has improved to a level where I think there's some confidence in projecting him ahead. So really excited to kind of see how he performs today and how he bounces back from what has kind of been kind of a tough stretch for him.
Yeah. Well, he's on the floor right now. He's on the right wing as it's brought up by Hugo Benitez. And here's Axel Julien. On the drive, kicking it out. Good ball movement here to Isaiah Mike. Cut off initially on the drive by Antoine Dio, formerly a teammate of Risacher at Asvel. And Risacher going to get called for a foul, getting tangled up with Cyril Langevine.
Yeah, Kevin, I want to ask you. I know you've watched a lot of international prospects, you know, over the years. What do you make of this international class? Obviously, Risacher is going to be one of the most interesting prospects in 2024 eligible players. But, I mean, it's kind of wide open, right? Alex Saar is going to be in the mix. Saloon, yeah. You mentioned, you know, is a potential top 10 prospect in this class as well. Yeah, I know you like this NBA draft class coming up.
Yeah, no, you're right, Kyle. I do like Tijan Salon. Just kind of his size and his ability to shoot the basketball. Now, he can get a little trigger happy at times where he takes some shots that I would consider questionable, but I guess sort of in the Wemby vein where he's kind of exploring his game. Now, Wemby had a lot more leeway to do stuff like that than Tijan Salon, who is you know, not a generational talent, but still a lottery potential talent. That's his cousin, yes. Melvin Agenca, with Saint-Quentin, an interesting guy who's looking like a second round pick right now. He can really get hot in a hurry from beyond the arc and does have some athleticism to him, as we see Bryce Brown with the bucket there. I love Nikola Topic. Did one of his games when USC was on its summer tour of Europe last year. They played his team when he was on Mega Mies. Now he's injured right now, but Nikola Topic, and back in the summer he was like on nobody's draft board, and I saw him, I'm like, this guy has to be one of the 60 best players in this upcoming draft class. So I am a big Topic fan for sure. So those are some of the guys in 2024. Nice bounce pass down low to make it 19-16. That's Maxime Salash inside. And I do want to, because I did the Basketball Without Borders game a class of 2025 guy from France. There's a couple of them. Armel Traore's brother. We all remember Armel Traore from his days being Wemby's teammates on Mets 92 last year. But his younger brother, Nolan Traore, is a 2025 draft prospect. And then the guy I'm really excited about in 2025, Noah Isenge. Just length for days. Just looks like a player. I'm a big fan of Isenge. I believe he's 2025 class. Might have an option for 2024. I forget exactly how old he is, but Isenge, watch out for him in the next year or two.
Okay, love that. Yeah, dropping some knowledge on the viewers here, because that is some insight you probably won't get anywhere else. Kevin absolutely loves international prospects and has an encyclopedia-like memory. It's incredible. And so, yeah, shout out to Kevin for doing the homework there. There's a lot of interesting international players coming up over the next few years.
Yeah, no, there really, really are. Is Risacher contesting the shot, but it's going to be an and one. Couldn't quite get there. That's Roanne able to take the lead, 20-19. Let's take another look at this replay. Kellen Grady getting out in transition and finishing.
Yeah, good job there from Risacher, just getting back in transition, trying to get kind of that weak side block and contesting. Gets a little bit of contact. Been impressed from him early in this game. It feels like he's not trying to rush things. He's kind of settling in and playing with some confidence and distributing. You know, he's not trying to force it. He's not trying to get to the basket. He's not trying to make his own shot or force the action. Did a good job, I think, of distributing to his teammates. This is what you want to see. Trying to work out of a slump, Risacher is. And I think you kind of let the game come to him. He's done a good job of doing that so far.
Yeah, 20-19, Roanne with the lead over Risacher and Bourg-en-Bresse. You can catch Kyle Boone's mock drafts on CBSSports.com. At one point, you had, I must have looked at an old mock draft where you had Risacher number one overall. I was looking at it yesterday. But if one is his ceiling, what is his floor in this draft?
Yeah, I think it's really difficult. I don't want to say impossible, but it's really difficult to see him falling out of the top five. When you're picking in the top five of the NBA draft, you're picking there for a reason. You're picking there because your team was bad. You had a ton of, you know, bad luck with injuries, maybe a combination of those two things. If you're an NBA team, you're going to try to swing for the fences because you want someone who is not going to come in and eventually be a really good role player for you, right? You want someone who can help transform your franchise. And I think when you look at what Risacher brings to the table, he's got a great frame. He moves really, really well for someone who's, you know, 6'8" with a plus wingspan. Defensively, checks a lot of boxes because he can defend multiple positions. He's a very eager and willing defender that I think you can project to the next level. His three-point shooting in terms of spot-up shooting has been really good this season. Now, you know, there's some development that probably needs to take place for him to validate being the number one pick in this draft. But I think NBA teams, their scouts, their front offices are paid to kind of make those decisions of projecting ahead what they can be in the next few years. And there's a lot of excitement, I think, within NBA front offices about Risacher specifically. And there's a real case that he could be the number one prospect and end up being the best player from this class in 2024.
Sekou Doumbouya with the bucket inside. Roanne expands the lead to four. They look inside for Maxime Salash, and it's taken away. DJ Cooper on the outlet. Grady with Risacher in front of him. Doumbouya, nice shot fake, gets to the rim and jams it down. It's the Sekou Doumbouya show, the native of Conakry, Guinea.
Yeah, Kevin, I love watching Doumbouya, and it's so funny because he was one of the first draft prospects that I followed when I started covering the draft for CBS. And even watching him now, it's like I still see something there with him. It's one of those things, I think, when you make an initial evaluation, you're like, you kind of just can't quit a guy. And off the bounce, like, he's super long. You know, he's really athletic. Defensively, when he's locked in, I think he could be a difference maker. So, you know, he's made some different stops around the NBA, obviously, and playing right now with the Roanne. But he's a guy who's still, you know, for whatever reason, it's kind of like Malik Monk the last few years. Like, and I think it's validated. I really liked him coming out of Kentucky, and I think he's done a good job kind of developing. But Doumbouya is another one where I'm like, I still believe. I still think there's an NBA player in there somewhere.
I'm with you, Kyle. I mean, he's only 23 years old. Like, this guy is 5 years away from his prime. It didn't work out for him in his first stint with Detroit and the Lakers. He has 96 games of NBA experience across three seasons with career averages of 5.7 points, 2.8 rebounds. And look, he was kind of buried on the bench with Delaware last year. That was a really good G League team. They won the G League title, so that was a deep squad. And he averaged like 3 points and two rebounds in 9 minutes per game. But, man, you can see it. I mean, he's shooting the ball well, obviously, in this game. Not known as a good three-point shooter, but could put it on the floor and, you know, just has the size and length that makes him look like an NBA player.
Yeah, yeah, and I think it's a pretty good encapsulation of how difficult it is to stick in the NBA. I mean,
yeah,
you know, guys who are top 10 prospects and top 10 picks are not guaranteed to make an NBA roster or to stick on an NBA roster for a long time. And Dumboya in his class was seen as like this guy has a chance to be a top five pick and a top five player in this class. It just hasn't worked out. Look at Risacher, by the way, flying.
Yeah. Nice alley-oop finish.
Yeah, really good job there. Running in transition, that's kind of where he is at his best right now. He has so much energy, so much springs. And so, yeah, I think there's a chance Dumboya makes a return to the NBA at some point. But if you can't shoot it from three at a high level, if you're, you know, a little bit turnover prone, I think he kind of got a reputation for being kind of all of those things. Yeah. It's really, really difficult to kind of stand out because the NBA is so deep right now.
Well, here is the lob threat that Risacher is, as Jeremy Morgan's going to come on for the final 4 seconds. And Risacher to the bench as he just gave up a box out rebound. Corner three, Kadri Moendadze, no good. And it will be out of bounds to Bourg for 0.4 seconds left here in the first quarter. We still have 0.4 seconds left, it looks like. See if we can take you back in real quick to take a look at a shot that didn't get off in time. We could have told you that was going to happen, but might as well see the rest of the quarter through. So it is a 2-point lead here for Roanne, 25-23. Risacher with the alley-oop finish. And that's one thing you were just talking about, Kyle. We discussed his spot-up shooting, but this guy is a terror in transition offensively. I mean, he's more than just a shooter. He's very athletic, his length. He can throw down some highlight reel dunks. And if you give him any sort of runway in the open court, watch out.
Yeah, I think there's different types of athleticism, Kevin, when you talk about, you know, explosiveness or maybe fluidity. I think Risacher kind of falls in the category of being in the more fluid type of athlete. He's really long, strider. He's really good when you get him out in transition. Maybe not the most explosive athlete, but certainly when you put him on the floor and when you're watching him, does a really good job of closing space. And here you can see kind of just the natural ability that he has, just being able to attack the basket, being able to finish lobs, as we saw earlier, getting out in transition. He had a block on an attempted layup earlier, obviously called for that foul, but love his instincts. And I think he's kind of a natural playmaker on both sides of the floor, which is really exciting, projecting him to the NBA level.
Now, I want to go back to a point you were making about Risacher a little bit earlier, how with the number one pick, you're not trying to pick a role player, right? But with Risacher, not that he's just a role player with Bourg on Bresse, but being used as a spot-up shooter, he is not being featured as the guy with the ball in his hands. Right. How much of a concern do you think that is for NBA scouts?
Yeah, I don't think it's a concern necessarily, you know, because you go look across the college basketball landscape, for instance, and you see, you know, like Rob Dillingham, who I think is the number one prospect in my rankings right now. He's coming off the bench for Kentucky, you know, and so like,
yeah,
it's very difficult to scout within context, but it's absolutely necessary knowing, you know, are they coming off the bench? Are they the number one option? Are they the number five option? Are they coming off the bench for a deep Kentucky team? And so all of that you have to take into account. You have to factor in age. You have to factor in kind of where bodies are physically, the competition that they're facing. I mean, I think if you put Risacher into the college basketball landscape right now, is he an All-American? Like, I think he probably would be. And so you have to kind of keep in context the level of competition and just how difficult it is, Kevin, to stand out in the Pro A. He's maybe not, you know, putting up Victor Wembanyama level stats this year, but like, who's doing that? No one is doing that. Yeah. Victor Wembanyama is one of one. And so, you know, when you're projecting ahead and kind of thinking about what he can be at the NBA level, I think there's a lot of excitement for Risacher just because he checks so many different boxes as a prospect.
Yeah, I mean, to your point, Kyle, if you're averaging 11 points per game in France, you are a really good basketball player. If you are averaging 11 points per game in France as a 19-year-old, to be 19-year-old in 3 weeks, he turns 19 on April 8th, you are very, very intriguing as a prospect.
Yeah, I mean, those are pretty good numbers in college basketball, right? I mean, if you kind of extrapolated that and put him on, you know, South Carolina and he played in the SEC or something, like, people would be looking at him like, oh, he's putting up some pretty solid numbers in the SEC. Like, that's a good league. He's shown some flashes and he's only 18 years old. He would be one of the youngest players in college basketball, just kind of to put that into context. So him doing this against, you know, professionals in a professional league in the Pro A, which is not an easy league to do so. I think that speaks volumes just again about how he's done developmentally over the last year for Bourg and Bress. And I think probably what he can become in the next few years as well.
And the other thing about it, he's doing this in 23 minutes a game. So it's not like he's playing 30 plus minutes. So he's basically at a point every other minute when he's out there.
Yeah. Yeah. So he's doing it efficiently. Obviously you want to see some growth from him. I would love it, Kevin, if he was the number one option, if Bourg and Bress just gave him the ball and let him cook. I don't think that's probably what is best for this team right now. And I don't think, honestly, that's probably what is best for his development right now. And I think that's important too, because, you know, last year you had Victor Wembanyama, and he was kind of thriving as the number one option who, you know, could make his own offense. He could operate as the secondary creator, do a lot of different things. But right now where Risacher is, he's not quite ready, I think, to be the number one option, to be the number one playmaker on an offense. And guess what? He's 18 years old. That's totally okay. That's totally okay where he is right now.
31-28 after the Jeremy Morgan dunk, former Memphis Hustler and Northern Iowa Panther, as Maxime Salash commits the crime there. So we're going to get a couple of free throws for Kellen Grady, who played his college ball at Kentucky after 4 years at Davidson, Massachusetts native. Some names you might recognize if you're a college basketball fan in this game, as Kellen Grady goes to the line. Another thing about Risacher that we should mention, kind of like with Victor Wembanyama, he's doing this on a winning team. Bourg-en-Bresse is a half game out of second in the LNB Pro A, just behind Asvel, who's 18-7. So Bourg-en-Bresse, a team that finished fifth in LNB Pro A last year at 19-15, they are on pace to smash past that wins total this year, already at 17 wins with 10 games to go. So you figure they're going to finish around 22-23 wins at the very least. So he's not putting up empty stats either. He's helping contribute to wins. And this team also, I should say, Kyle, is in the semifinals of the Euro Cup, which is like the second tier European competition behind Euro League.
Yeah, it's really impressive. What he's doing at his age in this role specifically, I think, is really exciting. Defensively, I think, is where probably the promise lies. You know, he's going to be kind of a natural defensive playmaker because, you know, 6'8", 6'9", he's got great kind of instincts as a defensive playmaker. He's very versatile. You know, we watch him on tape. It's so fun because he is just so eager to prove himself. And you don't see that often from NBA prospects, and maybe even from NBA prospects, you see players kind of shy away. You don't want to have stuff on tape that looks like, oh, well, he couldn't stay in front of this guy, or he couldn't quite switch on the perimeter against this guy. Risacher kind of takes on that challenge, and I think that's what makes him so exciting.
Roanne getting out on the break. It's a Dumbuya dunk to make it 37-30, Roanne. It's a team that probably gave Wemby the most fits out of any besides Monaco last year. They blasted Wemby's Mets 92 team away by 25 and 18 points in their two regular season meetings last year when Wemby was going up the likes of up against the likes of Silvio D'Souza, former Kansas Jayhawk.
Yep.
So Alexandre Bouzidi in alongside DJ Cooper, who leads Pro A in assists per game at 10.8 per contest.
Kevin, Bryce, what have you made of Wembanyama this year for the Spurs? I mean, we did several Wembanyama games last year for the NBA.
Yeah.
I think we were really excited about him. I also think we were trying to be safe about setting realistic expectations. And in hindsight, how silly was that? You know, like we were doing something special, and maybe we should have been alerting people a little bit more frequently because this guy has been exceptional for the Spurs.
Yeah, I agree with you 100%, Kyle, that I'm speaking for myself. I was trying to be safe because I just didn't want to be the guy who was going to say, oh, this guy's the next, you know, god in basketball. Oh. When, I mean, not that he's a deity, but he's close. I mean, I think my predictions last year, I went on record as saying, you know, I think it would be good if he averaged 14 points, 8 rebounds, maybe a couple of assists, 1 to 2 blocks per game. I did not envision 20, 10, 3 blocks, and nearly a steal and a half per game. It's insane what he's doing this year. And for maybe the first 2 months of the regular season, it was a good race between he and Chet for Rookie of the Year. I mean, there is no question anymore. There is only one guy who's going to win Rookie of the Year, and it's number one in a silver and black uniform. He has blown my expectations away. We knew he would have, I think, like, we knew eventually he was going to get to this level, but I did not expect it to be right now.
Yes. Yeah. No, I think that's exactly right. And especially because he's just a teenager coming into the NBA with such high expectations. You don't want to be the guy who's, you know, setting alarms and saying, hey, look, like this guy is different. The generational term gets kind of thrown around so frequently now that I think people are scared to maybe even use it. But, you know, when we watched Wembanyama last year with Mets 92 and kind of projecting ahead what he could be, I think the first thing I thought was like, this guy can be a future multi-time defensive player of the year. You look at, you know, Rudy Gobert, who's been spectacular in the NBA, you know, with the Jazz, with the Denver Wolves. He's a defensive player of the year type player who's won that award multiple times. And the impact that Wembanyama has, changing the geometry of the basketball floor, just with his length, with his instincts, on defense, it's just so spectacular to watch. And offense, every single night, you're seeing something that's like, oh, wow, I've never seen that before.
Ooh, avec le faute. Bryce Brown, a potential four-point play, getting hacked in the act. A late contest from Yanis Mohan. And Bryce Brown, former Final Four guy with Auburn, has a chance to put Bourg en Bresse in front.
They've done a good job here of kind of withstanding this Roanne run, and Bourg en Bresse has a chance to take the lead back here. Obviously, Risacher is still on the bench here. Has he returned since he gave up that closeout earlier on in the rebound? I think he's still riding.
He was subbed out with 4 seconds to go in the first quarter and has not returned.
Okay,
I'm trying to – you know how this LNB Pro A website doesn't always have a – updated stats. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to work through that right now, and apparently we are not getting the live stats from the LNB website. Spin move, Dumbuya. Oh, he's trying to get back to the NBA saying, don't lose faith in me, Kyle Boone.
I haven't. Yeah, it's not surprising to see Risacher take a little bit of breather here. This is kind of in line with his normal usage. I'd expect him to probably check back in soon. But, I mean, we saw him come off the bench. He checked out just before the end of the first quarter. He'll probably get some run here in the next few minutes.
Oh, Alexandre Bouzidi, very nicely done. This guy was on the U19 World Cup team for France in 2023 alongside Zaccharie Risacher, where to be quite honest, I mean, he had some pretty good shooting splits, but I do think there were some people that came away a little less impressive. Certainly with the Nike Hoop Summit, he was sort of a disappointment, but what he's done this year, and then the good shooting at U19 World Cup, helping to kind of revitalize his draft stock as Bouzidi completes the three-point play. It's a 42-40, a lead for Roanne. Jeremy Morgan off the ball screen and has it knocked away. DJ Cooper for Bouzidi, and he gets, oh, off his leg. Nice defense by Jeremy Morgan.
Great hustle there from Jeremy Morgan, saving that play. Looked like it was going to be an easy layup in transition. Just hustles back and strips him. What a play.
Yeah, that was nice. Got it clean. Very nicely done as Bryce Brown has it here. Former G League Elite Camp alum in 2019 hits the three to give Bourg-en-Bresse the lead. Did you scout Bryce Brown much when he was at Auburn?
I did. Yeah, I remember Bryce Brown pretty fondly, and I think he was, if I remember correctly, one of the pieces of an Auburn team that, you know, made a deep run in the NCAA tournament. I remember exactly how far they went, but I believe they went to the Final Four.
They did.
Yeah, they did, and I believe it was 2019. But yeah, Bryce Brown was a guy who I really liked. That team had, if you remember, Chuma Okiki, who I really liked. Jared Harper was a good guard on that team. So
yes.
Excited to see some Bryce Brown. I've always been a fan of his game. He brings a ton of energy.
Yeah, and if I remember correctly, Chuma Okeke got injured like in the Sweet 16 that year, and they still won a game or two without him. And that was a tournament run. They probably should have beat Virginia, and I can't remember if it was Bryce Brown, but Kyle Guy got fouled on a three. It might have been Bryce Brown who fouled him. Down two with like a second to go in OT, and he hit all three free throws to send Virginia to the national championship game.
Crazy, crazy sliding doors moment. Yeah, Auburn loses that game. Virginia ends up redeeming itself, going to win the national championship. They beat Texas Tech in the title game in overtime.
And that was their last NCAA tournament win.
Yes.
They certainly didn't get one last night.
No, they did not. Virginia ended up scoring 42 total points in a loss to Colorado State last night in the NCAA tournament. So, quick exit for the Cavaliers.
Yeah, so we played 16 and a half minutes in this game, and both Bourg-en-Bresse and Roanne have scored more than Virginia did last night.
That's correct. That is correct. Yes. And in fact, I think there was a counter during the broadcast last night where, you know, Virginia almost went 1 hour without making a basket, real time in between baskets. So
I think
that's not good.
You had the tweet. I believe it was 52 minutes. It went 9:48 Eastern to 10:40 Eastern, if I remember your Twitter correctly.
Yeah, okay. That sounds good. So, yeah, that's it's kind of playing on the theme of Wahoo Wah, but like kind of Wahoo Woo or like Wow or something like that. That was brutal offense being played by Virginia. That's kind of been the theme of that team this year.
Yeah. A one-point lead for Bourg-en-Bresse. With 3 minutes to go in the first half. Going inside to Dumbuya, fading away, and he finally misses. Roanne fans wanting a foul. Yeah, for real. Benitez de Morgan, Atois-Pois? No, doesn't go.
Almost got the friendly roll there. He's been kind of everywhere in the second quarter.
Jeremy Morgan having a nice season, 9.5 points, 2.6 rebounds, shooting 37% from three. Played in the BBL, the German BBL, last year with Bonn, as we got a blocking foul inside. These fans sound like they're about to start rioting. And they do get the whistle here. Well, that was a big collision inside.
That could have maybe gone the other way. I'm not sure. That was close. I could see maybe why they'd be a little upset there.
Jean-Denis Choulet, the head coach.
That's probably the hardest call to make as an official.
Oh, yeah. Block. Yeah, I would never want to be an official for that play exactly. I tell you, Kyle, I was a first base umpire for a beer league kickball tournament. It was the most intense 8 hours of my life. And this was for kickball. I can't imagine what it would be like being an official in a professional basketball league.
It's got to be torturous. Yeah. I mean, I've seen some little league officials, you know, really, really, really take a beating from, you know, from parents or from angry grandparents and stuff. And it's like, man, it's just, it's a difficult life to be an official. I respect what they do. And man, I'm not cut out for it. I know for sure. I probably couldn't even do the beer league kickball thing. So doing it at a high level at the pro A is like, just props to you. That's impressive.
Yeah. So it looks like there was an issue with the shot clock. So Axel Julian will inbound the basketball from the left hash. Here we go. 1 point game here in the first half. Bourg-en-Bresse in charge. Getting the screen, Julian driving past Mohandadze. Nice look inside to Bodian Massa, who spent last year with Bourg-en-Bresse as well. It's a 3-point lead. Excuse me, he was with Strasbourg last year, another red-wearing Pro A team in France. And a timeout called by Roanne with 2:15 to go in the first half. 47-44, Bourg-en-Bresse with the 3-point lead over Roanne. Kevin Dan alongside Kyle Boone. And we've really only seen one stint from Risacher in the first half. Hopefully we can see a little more of him in the final 2 minutes of this second quarter.
Yeah, we saw him early in this game kind of take advantage of a transition opportunity. I thought he did a really good job bringing some energy on defense. Got called for a foul, kind of contesting a shot, but love his effort, love his energy that he brought to this game. We haven't seen him really in the second quarter at all. And Bourg-en-Bresse has done a really nice job of kind of withstanding Roanne without him. So the energy that this team has played with Morgan has been particularly impressive. They're hanging tight, and they withstood some blows early in this game.
Now, Risacher, just one of a handful of guys from France this year who are going to be expected to be picked in the 2024 NBA draft. I want to get your thoughts a little bit on some of those other guys, like Alex Sarr, Tijan Salon, and Melvin Agençon.
Yeah, I think to me, Sarr is maybe the most interesting of that group. Different type of prospect. You know, this 2024 class is particularly loaded at the wing position. You look and kind of project ahead. Risacher is someone who's 6'8", can fill multiple spots on the wing, and defensively can switch onto multiple spots. And I think projects as a wing at the NBA level. You know, guys like Ron Holland, Matas Buzelis, those guys. And Sarr is a little bit different in that, you know, he's 7 foot tall. He's got great instincts for his size, really good shot blocker, a difference maker totally on defense, just because of the way he defends in space and the way he can cover ground. The top of this class, I think is kind of wide open. So, you know, we talked a little bit earlier about how, who knows exactly what's going to happen. Melvin Ajinka is another one who, I'm a little bit lower on him. I think he could end up being a sneaky first round pick, somewhere in that 20 to 40 range. The international class, just as a whole, Kevin, is impressive again. And it's becoming a theme as kind of we scout the NBA. It's definitely not a fluke. You know, it used to be kind of college dominated at the top by one and dones. Definitely not the case anymore. A ton of international guys every single year contending for that number one pick.
And the talent from France just continues to pour out of the country. I'm curious, France or Paris is the host of the 2024 Olympics. They're going to have Gobert. They're going to have Wembanyama. They're going to have a really good team. Evan Fournier, you'd imagine, be on that team, along with a lot of other high-level professionals. Frank Ntilikina is a really good international player for them. How they beat the United States in Tokyo in the prelims last year. How much of a chance do you give them against USA this year in a potential gold medal game?
I would give them a real good chance.
Me too.
The French have been sensational, kind of in this format. You know, in the U19s, I remember I watched Victor Wembanyama, and I think he took on Zach Edey and Chet Holmgren, and he was by far the best player on the floor. And so there's a sense of pride, I think, that they have kind of in representing their country and representing their team. And if some of these guys are going to play, I think they'll have a real chance to take down Team USA.
Kadri Mohandadze is a 28% three-point shooter on the season. This guy has hit like four threes this quarter. He has been en fuego and just hit another one to give Roanne a four-point lead.
Yeah, they have not been able to stop him and get back in transition in this game, and that has been a huge difference. Bourg and Brest just kind of playing from behind, playing chase. It feels like they're just one step slow in this game. I'm surprised they're able to keep it this close so far, and we really haven't seen much of Risacher in this first half as well.
Yeah, he's probably at about 4 minutes. Again, the LNB Pro A website is not updating live stats today, unfortunately. It is about a 50-50 proposition. As much as we love Betclic Elite Basketball, they could improve their live stats page over there in France. But I say he's at about 4 minutes. He has the one dunk. That's his only bucket. And I cannot remember another counting stat per se. Do you remember one?
No, I think he's got one basket and then he's got a foul. And I think that's it. Yeah. So I think he made a mistake towards the end of the first quarter where I believe it was he forgot to box someone out, kind of let his guy go around him, and he got the quick hook, hasn't been out there since.
Yeah, you know, as I'm thinking back through that first half, and again, we do not have the help of stats, but I do think the reason we haven't seen him is that he has two fouls. I'm pretty sure on that box out, he picked up a foul. Then he picked up another foul on the left wing. So that would explain why we haven't seen him in the second quarter.
Okay, yeah.
Or at least partly explain it. Mm-hmm. Axel Julien for three. Gets it to go. 1 point game. Last possession, DJ Cooper. Oh, what a pass. You can see how he averages almost 11 assists per game. And Sekou Doumbouya with another three to beat the buzzer to give Roanne a four-point lead. Going into the halftime locker room, Doumbouya with another triple. He is well past 10 points in the first half as Roanne takes a 56-52 lead at the break. It's the Sekou Doumbouya and Kadri Mohandadze show for Roanne as they have the lead over the Fighting Risachers as we take a look at some highlights in a little bit. But Boone, what would you take away from that first half?
Yeah, it's I think everyone probably tuned in to watch Risacher, and it's turned into the Sekou Doumbouya show. He's been fantastic for Roanne in this first half. Been really aggressive, made some shots, been really confident, taking some deep shots there. Got one right before the end of the first half. And I think Bourg and Brest has done a really nice job. Roanne has made some shots that I'm not sure are sustainable going into this second half. Some guys who, are career three-point shooters that maybe you would just suggest leaving open that have made some shots. And we'll see. But Bourg and Brest has done a nice job responding, making shots, and kind of hanging tough despite not playing very well in the first half.
Yeah, to your point, Kyle, Sekou Doumbouya in his NBA career, we'll take a look at some highlights. 26% from three in the NBA. Kadri Mohandadze this year, 28% from three. And those guys, I mean, they missed once or twice, but they were on fire in the first half. So I'm with you. I don't think that is sustainable for Roanne. I expect them to cool off a little bit in the second half as we take a look at some highlights from the second quarter.
Yeah, and I think Bourg and Brest did a really nice job. Morgan played with a ton of energy, kind of with Risacher in foul trouble. They needed someone to add some defensive effort, some intensity, which Risacher does a really good job bringing to the table. He's very eager, kind of switching on to multiple positions. He's a guy who plays with a lot of confidence on that end of the floor. And Morgan was able to impact the game in a way that Bourg and Brest was able to hang tight. They made some shots there. A deep contested three, and did a good job sharing the basketball as well. So it's a close game going into the half, and maybe it shouldn't be, but it has been so far.
Yeah, take a look at Bryce Brown hitting another three. He can get hot in a hurry. Nice feed inside to Bodian Massa. I made it 47-44. And then Kadri Mohandadze went off. Trey ball there. Make it 47 apiece. Trey ball in the corner. 50-49. And Roanne was not done hitting threes. They were up four. And then Axel Julian hitting the three. And then Sekou Doumbouya to beat the buzzer to cap off just an incredible first half for him and Roanne. All right, we're going to take a break. Come on back with the second half here on the NBA app. Zaccharie Risacher and Bourg Ambres trailing Roanne by four. We welcome you back here on the NBA app. Kevin Down alongside Kyle Boone of CBS Sports, watching Bourg-en-Bresse and Zaccharie Risacher going up against Sekou Doumbouya and Choral Roanne here on the NBA app. At the half, it is 56-52. Roanne, the homestanding team, just above the cut line to get demoted to Pro B right now with 10 games remaining and 8-16 with the 56-52 lead over third place Bourg-en-Bresse, who will be headed to the Euro Cup semifinals, where they'll be taking on Beşiktaş of Turkey in the round of four in a best of three series there. Anyway, so we're here mainly to watch Zaccharie Risacher, and unfortunately we didn't get a chance to see a lot of him, Kyle, because of what we believe to be two personal fouls on him in about a 4 to 5 minute stretch in the first quarter. Did not play in the second quarter. So outside of staying out of foul trouble and getting onto the court in the first place, what would you like to see out of Risacher in the second half?
Yeah, I would like to see more of him personally. And I want to give a shout out here to Skins Hoops 86 on Twitter, who is a great follow. And he actually just alerted me to the fact that RC Buford, who is the Spurs CEO, is actually in town watching Risacher as well. And so, yeah, he probably made the trip thinking he would watch a little bit more Risacher as well. So hopefully we'll see a little bit more. But when he's out there, you know, I want to see him with the ball in his hands. I want him to see a little bit more aggressive. When he was in this game earlier, it was a little bit passive, and I think that was a good thing, kind of easing into the game and getting a feel for things, because he has been on a bit of a slump. Want to see him be aggressive, attack the basket, see if he can make some plays on offense. Then defensively, again, just want to be able to see him switching on to defenders, doing what he does, being aggressive, and disrupting things on defense.
Well, he is out there to start the second half. He gets a screen from Massa, has it on the wing. Nice skip pass to Isaiah Mike for three. It rattles out, and the rebound going to be saved in by Tucker, but right to Bodian Massa, and he lays it up and in.
Yeah, really good job there from Risacher. You know, I want to see him be aggressive, and maybe that's not the most important thing for him right now. He's letting the game kind of come to him, just passes it off to an open teammate who has a good look, misses it, but they end up scoring. Really good job kind of feeling out the Roanne defense early in this game.
A little Marché inside, a travel on Yanis Mohan, former Oklahoma City Blue player. You see him take the extra step. And I think he caught the end of that highlight. He had already moved his right foot and lost his pivot. So Risacher working off the ball in the right corner. Jaquan Lewis moving it around. Opposite corner for Jeremy Morgan, who had a nice first half. He'll fire three and gives Bourg-en-Bresse the lead.
Continuing what he started in this game, which was he shot really well in the first half. He was all over the place defensively, brought a lot of energy when Bourg-en-Bresse needed it.
The turnover. Risacher got screened by his own man, basically. Morgan going to go to Massa, finds a cutting Isaiah Mike, puts it up and one for the former Golden State Summer Leaguer who played his college ball at Duquesne and SMU.
Yeah, good job there just moving without the basketball. That's what I would like to see a little bit more of from Risacher. He's such a good spot-up shooter. It's difficult to ask him when he finds an open space in the defense to run off of three-point line, especially when he feels he has an open shot. But moving without the basketball, I think an area where he could improve as a prospect, still only 18 years old, feeling out some of the kind of finer points of his game. Would love to see him improve in that area.
He turns 19 on April 8th, so about 3 weeks away from his 19th birthday. Fighting through the screen, Antoine Dio going up top to Dumbuya. Can he keep the hot hand alive? Hands it off to Yanis Mohan, a Pro-A All-Star, runs it up short.
Good contest there from Risacher. You know, he's got two fouls, has a chance to maybe be a little bit standoffish, and certainly that would be expected and maybe even acceptable. But good job contesting on the defensive possession there from Risacher.
Bodian Massa will make it to the line. He did not get the shot inside. He probably should... Probably thinks he should have made at least one of those. We have a, looks like an early timeout, perhaps. Yep, by Roanne. So 2:15 into the third quarter, 7-0 start to the second half for Bourg-en-Bresse. And while we don't have a counting stat from Risacher here in the third quarter, I think we both like what we have seen from him. He's been very aggressive on defense, picking up Antoine Dio, the Roanne point guard. Full court, a lot of times really kind of pressure defense in the half court, and then a nice skip pass to the wing for what would have been an assist if the three had been made.
Yeah, I was going to say, he should have more assists maybe if his teammates had made some shots and stood up for him, but he had a really nice cross-court pass that just the shot just rimmed out, and it did a really nice job of not deflecting a shot, but certainly I think deterring a shot around the basket, giving a good contest. That's what you want to see from Risacher, still being aggressive, still being assertive. Yep. He's not in foul trouble yet, only got two fouls, but bordering on foul trouble. And as we saw in the first half, It feels like they're trying to be kind of conservative with how they play him. They don't want to get him into foul trouble because possibly they want him down the stretch.
Yeah, again, 23 minutes per game is what he averages, and so you figure he has a lot of runway to play here in the second half. As we got Bodian Massa to the line, as Kyle Boone said earlier from Skins Hoops 86 on Twitter, RC Buford at the game, and well, there is a long line of French studs playing for the San Antonio Spurs. It'd be very interesting to see them draft Zaccharie Risacher.
Yeah, and it certainly could be in the mix. You know, depends on how the standings fall, how the lottery balls shake. And I think if you're the Spurs watching Wembanyama this season, you have to hope that wherever they're picking, hopefully there's a point guard who is worthy of being picked in that same spot. Topic comes to mind, just because, you know, the size, the skill, the playmaking ability. They need to find someone who can pair with Wembanyama long term. And, you know, if Risacher is the best available prospect when the Spurs are on the board, I wouldn't put it past the Spurs to do that. You know, they're not going to take a player that is maybe a better fit over a better prospect long term. So Buford and Spurs doing their homework here today with Risacher in action.
We're going to get a foul down low, I believe, on Roanne. It was a shot. It would have been a shot clock violation, but are they going to call the foul on Bodian Massa? Let's see. Where the foul? Oh, yeah, this is on Massa, I think. Yep. So it'll stay with Roanne, but yeah, you kind of, when you're thinking about the Spurs, you kind of hear about two needs for them. One is a point guard, and Trey Jones is a good point guard, but he's kind of viewed as a backup point guard long term. And then two is some more shooting, and that's where Risacher would come into play with San Antonio, as Dumbuya is called for the travel, wave off the bucket. But if you were the Spurs and you're looking for a point guard, would you want to go through the draft for that? Or would you, because Vic is a guy who looks like he's ready to win right now, would you try to find a more veteran guy in free agency?
No, I'd be, if I'm the Spurs in particular, I'd be totally fine going through the NBA draft to try and address that need. One, because Wembanyama is so young. Yes, he's ready to contend right now, but I think if you hit on the right player, you could get someone who fits a similar timeline or even the same timeline as Wembanyama. The Spurs are so good at scouting. They put in a lot of resources. There's only a few teams in the NBA who really devote that much time to scouting and preparing. I think they're probably in a unique position where they would be very confident making that decision as well. And really at the top of the 2024 NBA draft class with Wembanyama are kind of already in tow. There's several guys who, you know, maybe don't fit into a neat category as quote unquote a point guard, but the way the NBA is played right now, I think they could find some guys who could fill that need or at least help fill that void as a kind of a playmaking presence. Reed Sheppard comes to mind. He's been fantastic for Kentucky this season, you know, shooting 52% from 3-point range. His assist numbers, 4.5 assists per game. Good, maybe not great. He's not relied on as kind of their primary playmaker. But if you watch Reed Sheppard play basketball this season, you've seen some really high-level reads and some passes that he's made. So I would be excited if I'm the Spurs picking in that, you know, top six range potentially, and feel confident that you could get a guy long-term to pair with Wembanyama who you would be really happy with.
I mean, 4.5 assists per game for in college for a guy who's not your primary ball handler, that's really good.
And he's made five starts on the season, primarily coming off the bench. He's been exceptional. I think down the stretch of this season has been Kentucky's best player. Defensively, he holds up really nicely. He has great instincts. Shoots the ball with, like, just if you were going to draw a shooter up in the lab, his form, the way his shot is released, just picture perfect. And a really fun, exciting player who, no, I think, again, probably goes somewhere in the top five, top six of this 2024 class.
Antoine Dio, 35 years old, hits both free throws, and those are the first 2 points of the third quarter for Roanne. Stops a 14-0 Bourg-en-Bresse run to start the second half. Risacher at the foul line, working off the ball. We have a whistle on the ball. Bourg on Brest Rock. And Julian's inbounds pass gets deflected and stolen, and Risacher's got to be careful here. Dumbuya, perhaps cooling off. Had a three
Love
blocked
that
in the corner earlier.
Yeah, that was great stuff from Risacher. Again, I think we're both worried that he may pick up another foul and be in foul trouble and get vanquished to the bench. But loose ball, he's scrambling for it. Love that energy. That's what he brings to the table.
Isaiah Mike hits the three. It has been a dominant third quarter for Bourg-en-Bresse thus far against 16th place Roanne. Corner three in the air and short. Chance to further extend the lead. Jaquan Lewis, former Wisconsin Herd point guard in the G League, after playing collegially at VCU, gets fouled. Julian will throw it in as Maxime Salash comes in. Risacher in the far corner. Here he is with the rock, sizing up Kellen Grady. Gets stripped. And then commits a foul.
Yeah,
rough sequence there for Risacher.
Not what you want to do. I like the idea there. Risacher trying to attack the basket off the dribble. That's where he needs to kind of clean up some things. His handle can be a bit loose sometimes, a little bit high. Just gets stripped trying to attack the basket and makes a silly foul. Probably in frustration. Can't have that.
We believe that's his third foul, and we do not have the benefit of stats, so doing this in our heads is Sekou Doumbouya banks it in. Roanne trying to get back into this game. Lewis throws it away. Ooh, taken right back by Julian. And a nice pass to a cutting Isaiah Mike, the all-star in France. Puts Bourg-en-Bresse back up by 11.
What a pass, what a cut. Good finish there.
Yeah. Well, a nice feed here. Doumbouya off the glass. The fans chanting Défense. I love that chant in France. Open three, Jaquan Lewis from way downtown.
They've had some answers in this second half, shooting the ball at a really high level, and their defense has really stepped up.
A 12-point lead for Bourg-en-Bresse. I go to Doumbouya. Working on Mike. Nearly had it poked away. Tough shot. Draws the foul. Do you remember where you had Doumbouya going in your 2019 mock draft?
Yes, but I mean, do I have to admit it live on air?
Fair enough.
I think I had him number 7. In that class.
Okay.
And again, you know, hand up was probably wrong on that, but it's first of all, I'll leave it to the professionals. I'm a not professional scout who, you know, that was my first year, I believe, and really liked what he bring to the table physically. Just has not worked out for him in terms of his NBA career. Again, I still believe. I'm still holding out hope. He's still in his young 20s. He showed some flashes here. He's looked really good.
I still believe, too. And don't worry, I've had more than my fair share of draft misses. just to share one with you, is actually Julian hits the three. I was a Warriors fan growing up. I'm lucky enough to work in the organization with their G League team, fill in on their Golden State radio broadcast when Tim Roy can't do it. In the 2009 NBA draft, being a Stanford men's basketball manager, I was really hoping that the Warriors would select Jordan Hill with the number 7 pick, and was upset when they didn't. So it's probably good that they did not listen to me.
Yeah. What a sliding doors moment, potential turn of events. Jeez. Yeah. It's a good thing that I listen to Kevin.
Yeah.
That 2019 class was interesting too. I mean, Zion Williamson, Ja Morant, number one and number two, obviously, but even at the top in that lottery, Demboya was number 15. You know, there were some guys who I think a lot of people were high on that just for one reason or another just haven't quite panned out in the NBA. Jarrett Culver, Jackson Hayes, Cam Reddish, some guys who, you know, maybe are starting to turn a corner. It's still early.
Yeah.
A really hyped class that maybe didn't turn out to be kind of what people had hoped and expected from it.
Maxime Salash and Cyril Langevin mixing it up a little bit down low. The two free throws for the native of Belarus, Maxime Salash. Finals MVP in Belarus in 2020. Played last year in the VTB United League. 2 years ago in ECB. Largely considered the top domestic league outside of the United States. I'm going to say foul on the floor, apparently. Open three. Complete defensive breakdown as Axel Julien hits the three.
So, Kevin, 2009. The Warriors take Jordan Hill instead of Stephen Curry. Does that mean Curry goes to the Knicks at number eight? What happens?
I think so. So I interned the 2009 NBA draft like as a gopher for Jay Billis. There was definitely a lot of Knicks fans who wanted Stephen Curry.
With good reason.
Those Knicks fans knew more about basketball than I did. As DJ Cooper lays it up and in, 80-69. So Roanne getting this back down to 11. They were down 16. Another thing I remember from that draft is, as we see Maxime Salash, that's Maxime Corby. Passing it off. Corby on the follow. Make it a 13-point lead. Risacher on the bench now with what we believe to be three fouls. But so Brandon Jennings was not in the green room. And I'm not sure he expected to get drafted 10th overall. But he went 10th overall. And then David Stern says that he's not in attendance. So about 15 minutes later, maybe a half hour later, someone comes into my ear says, Brandon Jennings is here, and we're going to introduce him. And so it was my job to tell Andy Katz's handler that Brandon Jennings was here and that Andy Katz was going to interview Brandon Jennings. And so, like, before the 14th or 15th pick of the draft, whatever, is, you know, before we announce the – David Stern goes up there and says, before we announce the 14th, 15th pick, I'd like to let you know that Brandon Jennings, selected 10th overall, is here. And then he walks out and shakes David Stern's hand. It was, like, one of the most baller things I'd ever seen.
That's incredible. And I can't believe that would happen even as recently as 15 years ago. You know, I mean, the mock draft atmosphere, the intel that we have in the NBA draft scouting community, I think has improved dramatically. People are so into the NBA draft, into scouting, that, you know, I can't imagine a player going top, a number 10 in the class, just not showing up in the green room because he didn't think he would, you know, potentially go that high. So, yeah, that's a crazy story to hear. I'm glad he made it, though.
Yeah, and then, you know, dropped to 55 in an NBA game not too much later. Kellen Brady hitting the three. Brandon Jennings was really like the first American, one of the first Americans to go overseas to spend his pre-draft year. He was kind of a pioneer in that respect, went to play in Italy. I don't think we fully understood and appreciated how good those overseas leagues are, especially in Italy. Nice take there, but the finish not quite for Hugo Benitez. DJ Cooper down the lane, off the glass, no, and that will do it for the third quarter. 84-74, Bourg-en-Bresse over Roanne with at least 10 minutes to play. Kevin Dana, Kyle Boone with you. Zaccharie Risacher did not score a bucket in that quarter, but until he picked up the third foul and got picked before that, he did do a lot of positive things in that period.
Yeah. Again, we don't have the stats, but his plus minus has to be off the charts right now. The way that they started this second half, really impressive. His energy that he brings, had some fresh legs, clearly, because he missed the entire second quarter. The energy that he had played with on defense, I think, really exceptional. Offensively, kind of letting the ball come to him. You know, he does a really good job, Kevin. He's not required or asked to be the primary playmaker. You know, really not even the secondary playmaker. He's more frequently kind of just standing in the corner, but he does a really good job of being attentive, of staying locked in. You see him in the corner, he's got his hands kind of up, like, I'm ready to go. And he does that on both ends. And I think for someone in his role, you know, given that he's a potentially the number one pick in the next 2024 NBA draft class, it would totally be reasonable to expect or even see him at times show some frustration. Hey, I'm not getting the ball in the rotations. But the way that he's locked in, he has a really good attitude. And I think that's infectious because it clearly, you know, we saw him diving for a loose ball. He doesn't really care about, you know, potentially the counting stats. He's trying to win games. He's really aggressive on both ends of the floor, trying to do what is best for his team. And I think that's what's been most impressive for me today.
We would ask this question a ton on the Wemby cast last year. Best fit for Wemby. Where do you think would be a nice landing spot for Risacher?
Yeah, I mean, take your pick. I think anyone with who's going to end up picking in the top 10 would make a lot of sense. The Grizzlies, I think, would be kind of fascinating. A team that's pretty young. They already have kind of a point guard in place with John Morant. Someone who I think could bring to the table shooting at a high level and defense at a high level. You know, maybe a really high floor type of prospect who, you know, has some star potential as well. The Grizzlies, I think, would make a lot of sense. The Spurs, you know, we talked a little bit about maybe them looking to add some shooting or maybe even at point guard, some playmaking. One of those two directions would make a lot of sense. I think he would fit well in the Spurs system because of the size that he brings, because of his defensive versatility and his shooting, his spot-up shooting ability. They need to add some dynamic shooting and playmaking off of Victor Wembanyama. He does a really good job kind of adding a different dimension in that regard.
All right, so if the Spurs are on the clock and both Nikola Topic and Zaccharie Risacher are available, which way do you think they go?
Oh, man. If I'm the Spurs and Topic is there and Risacher is there, I mean, I love drafting for need, and I think Topic would fit a need. But I would not be able to pass on Risacher just because the upside, the potential. I think there's a tier break between those two prospects. I'm really high on Topic. I think he's a guy who I'd have to go back and look, but I think I have him top five on my big board. So, you know, I think you can make a reasonable case one way or another. But Risacher, you know, it's at 6'8", the length that he brings, the production that he's already done in the Pro A as an 18-year-old, his shooting from three-point range, and then hopefully projecting ahead what he can be as a playmaker and putting the ball in his hands. His jumper, I think it looks polished, and I think is ready kind of to take the next step. He's going to eventually, I think, add some shot creation, some playmaking to his game. And if he's able to do that, he could very well wind up being, I think, the number one prospect to come out of this 2024 NBA class.
Interesting. Théo Pierre-Justin with the layup the other way for Roanne, combated by a three for Maxime Salash and Borkan Bresson. Quickly the other way, a layup for Roanne. It's Kellen Grady to make it a 10-point game. End-to-end action as Risacher starts the fourth on the bench. Bryce Brown a three. No good. Foul in transition, and you see a couple of fans putting up the X, wanting a faute anti-sportive, unsportsmanlike foul, but I don't think so there. It looked like he was going for the ball.
Yeah, I agree with him.
So, 10-point game, 90-80. As we hopefully await the return of Zaccharie Risacher to this ball game. DJ Cooper with it here. thought about the step back. They go inside to Mohan. Yanis Mohan. And a foul called. All right. We've talked about the top of the draft. Who's a guy you like who's not getting, like, number one or top five consideration that you think could sneak up on some people?
Yeah, there's one guy I think I would highlight here just because, you know what? It's March Madness season. People are filling out their brackets. They're trying to figure out what picks to make. Tennessee has a stud named Dalton Connect, who is fantastic.
Oh, I love Connect.
He started his career at the junior college level, played the last two seasons at Northern Colorado in the Big Sky, and didn't really get a ton of attention until last year. He averaged 20 points per game. Ends up signing with Tennessee, averages just north of 21 points per game this season for the Vols, a team that defensively they've been fantastic the last few years. Offensively, they've really struggled, and Connect has added a dimension that they absolutely need. He's a guy who I think absolutely is going to end up potentially in the conversation as a top 10 prospect in this class. And if you had told someone that Dalton Connect would be a potential top 10 prospect in this class, 6 months ago, you would have probably been laughed off the stage because he was nowhere on the radar. Just a guy who was coming from a mid-ranger ranks and has just completely dominated. One SEC Player of the Year, really exciting prospect. He's very athletic. He's a good scorer, can create his own shot, shooting around 40% from three. Just kind of checks a ton of boxes in terms of projecting ahead what he can be as kind of an NBA 2 guard at the next level.
Yeah, I love Dalton Connect. I am a huge fan. I mean, I unfortunately haven't had a chance to watch Tennessee a ton this year. I'll be getting into the film and college basketball, you know, once the G League season ends. But what I have seen of him, I am a huge, huge fan. So I am with you there on that. Let me ask you about another big college name since the NCAA tournament is coming up. And Zach Edey's probably trying to wash the taste out of the 2023 NCAA tournament out of his mouth this year. I've seen him on draft boards mid-second round, somewhere in the second round. What do you see as his NBA future?
Yeah, I think Edey may be one of the most polarizing prospects in this class. And the difference between the scouting community and maybe like just the fan base community writ large, there's maybe a gap between expectations for him at the NBA level. He's been the best player in college basketball for 2 years. He has dominated with a throwback, kind of old school style, playing in the low post and the mid post, and dominating with paint touches. I think he could be a backup NBA center at the next level. He's 7'4". He struggles to defend in space, obviously. But I think there's some promise and some potential in him being able to shoot it from three-point range. He's never going to be, you know, a switchable defender. But for what he is, which is the most dominant interior scorer who can be a really physical interior presence, I think at the NBA level, there's a role for him. Now, whether that means he's going to be picked, you know, 15 in the draft or closer to 50, I think that's still to be determined. But there's a lot of hope, I think, in the scouting community that he may end up playing his way into the late first round, which would be obviously remarkable. He's 22 years old, one of the older prospects in the NBA draft class. And you don't see guys who are 7'4" with his type of game and the way that he plays go high in the NBA draft anymore. So, you know, he would have to buck a lot of recent trends. But again, yeah, one of the most dominant players the last few years in college basketball. It's really, really interesting to see kind of what his NBA draft stock is going to look like over the next few months.
Sekou Doumbouya at the line. Zaccharie Risacher back into the game here with a little more than 6 minutes to go. He's probably played about 10 minutes in this game, Risacher. Here's the second free throw for Doumbouya. No good. And Bourg on Bresse is just completely taking the reins of this one. They were down 4 at the half. They lead by 17 now, scoring Roanne 46-25 here in the third and fourth quarters combined. Risacher and they give it to a posting up Maso as his pocket pick from behind. Antoine Dio. Dumbuya to the rim, no. Down the lane, off the glass, and in for Maxime Corby.
Good job there getting out of transition. And you could tell from the way that Roland is playing this last few minutes, some desperation, a little bit exasperated. Yeah. I haven't been able to get anything going offensively to keep up with this Bourg Brest team. Kind of forcing the action here late.
There's Morgan. Risacher in the near corner. Just outside of the frame. Now he's in it. And a full technique on Jean-Denis Choulet, I believe, the head coach of Roanne. He got hit up with a T. So to the line for Jaquan Lewis. Just giving a high five to his A-10 buddy, Cyril Langevin.
Yeah, you could see that one coming. You could sense the frustration from Milan. This game has really gotten out of control, out of their grasp, and in a hurry, too. This has been a really good fourth quarter, second half, really, for Bourg Brest.
So 100-81, Bourg Brest by 19. They haven't needed a lot of Risacher today, but certainly looking good for Bourg Brest. If they win this game, they will be tied for second with Asvel. Asvel will still hold on to the number two position as a result of the tiebreaker, as Asvel has handled Bourg Brest this year. Kevin Dana, Kyle Boone with you here on CBS Sports, CBSSports.com. So you've got a lot of NCAA tournament watching coming up. What's your bracket looking like? What's your final four, Mr. Boone?
Yeah, bracket's looking absolutely perfect. So far, have not missed any picks. Now, granted,
you're two for two.
Yes. I did nail the first two. The first four action started yesterday. It's going to finish today, and then first round obviously starts tomorrow. UConn looks pretty interesting. Purdue looks pretty interesting. Houston looks pretty interesting. My goodness, I just named all number one seeds. Yeah, what a bunch of hot takes here on the NBA draft. Broadcast. So yeah, but you gotta get your bracket in before it locks tomorrow, and you can find my bracket on cbssports.com if you want to challenge me. Have at it.
Hey Kyle, is there any truth to the rumor that your middle name is Chalk?
What is that? Chalk?
Picking all one seeds.
You know, I think in my bracket I actually did not pick all number one seeds. I'll have to pull it up here. I did pick UConn to win the national championship. I do have them facing Duke in the national championship game. So
Duke's a four seed.
Yeah, and I've got Arizona in the final four. That's a number two seed. So I've got 2-1 seeds in the final four, a two seed, and a four seed. So.
Arizona. I was going to say Arizona and Duke, true Cinderellas, of course.
Of course, yes. You know, it's funny, too, because Arizona, everyone's like, oh, well, that's kind of chalky. Arizona lost to a 15-seed Princeton last year in the first round. So, you know, anything can happen in the NCAA tournament. It's even when you think you're making chalk picks, sometimes it's just like it's totally unpredictable. NCAA tournament, March Madness.
Oh, yeah.
Anything can happen. It's the best time of year.
No, it really is. Nice move by Langevin. He's at 103-83. I'm with you. I think UConn's winning the title. They've been really, really good this year. And they obviously have the pedigree of winning a national championship.
They've been good. I mean, it's tough to rule them out. You look at recent trends. No defending champion in college basketball on the men's side has made it past the Sweet 16 since Florida did it in 2007. It's been 11 years since the number one overall seed won the national championship. Obviously, UConn falling into both of those categories. So Statistically, they've been the most dominant team, I think, in college basketball. Their talent level is insane. Dan Hurley, one of the best coaches in college basketball. But yeah, we'll see. We'll see how it goes. I mean, everyone's going to be coming for them. They're the guy that everyone. They're going to be their Super Bowl. They'll get their best every single night.
Risacher going 2 for 2 from the line, showing off that free throw stroke. But he is only 70% from the foul line this year. Better than the 57% he shot at Asvel last season. Stolen away. Jaquan Lewis to Risacher, bobbles it. Goes up with the left hand. Nicely done over right shoulder.
Yeah, good job there from Risacher. We wanted to see him kind of move without the basketball. A good job there identifying the transition opportunity. Gets the ball, nearly bobbles it away, but able to hang on to it and finish there.
Oh, this is stat padding time, Boone. That's some empty numbers in a 24-point game with 3 minutes to go.
And this is a good opportunity for him, too. You know, we make a joke about him stat padding, but, you know, this is a chance where he's playing up against other professionals and with the game kind of squarely in hand. This is a good chance for him to kind of showcase himself and be a little bit more aggressive, be a little bit more assertive. Hasn't really been the case today, just because he's been in foul trouble. They really haven't needed him, but would like to see him be aggressive here down the stretch, especially on offense.
I'm surprised they did not call a foul on Langevine there. I guess the referees want to go home too. Antoine Dio.
Yeah, he ran into a brick wall.
Yeah. So some of the espoirs coming in, the young players, U21 guys. Timeout called 107-83. And if you're just joining us on the NBA app, it was Roanne who had a 4-point halftime lead. But Bourg-en-Bresse started the second half on a 14-0 run, Kyle, and they did not look back.
Yeah, they've been tremendous in this second half. Really, when their backs were against the wall in the first half, they struggled. Risacher was riding the bench with foul trouble early in this game. Second half just feels like the momentum completely flipped. Some of their shots they were missing in the first half started to fall defensively. They really stood tall. And Roanne missed some shots that maybe they were making in the first half. Sekou Doumbouya cooled off a little bit in the second half after a really strong first half. Still a really impressive day from him. But this has been an impressive performance and a really resilient performance from this Bourg-en-Bresse team.
Yeah, no, it really has. Risacher still out there for the final, and 2:58, I believe, is left on the clock as Bouzidi will bring it up. And we'll play out the string here from Roanne. Trying to stay above the cut line, if you will. Bottom two teams are relegated to Pro B at the end of the year. Then the Pro B regular season champion and the playoffs champion move up to Pro A. One of those teams, Saint-Quentin, who has Melvin Agençal, who you will see on Saturday. They are actually in a Pro A playoff position this year as Langevine makes the layup. And they are taking on Cholet. So it's Tijon Salon. Zaccharie Risacher misses the three. First three-point attempt of the game. It'll be Tijon Salon and Cholet going up against Melvin Agençal and Saint-Quentin this Saturday on the NBA app.
Forward to that. Yeah, there's been some good action on the NBA app, so be sure to tune in.
That's for sure. Marche inside on the youngster. For Bourg-en-Bresse, one of the U21 guys, as Doumbouya will hit the bench. A job well done for him, but can't say the same about the second half for Roanne. A whistle here. By the way, there is no 17 listed on Bourque en Bresse on Eurobasket or my chart. So apologies to number 17 on Bourque en Bresse. We know not your name. And the live stats still not working, so our apologies. Bouzidi throws it right to Roland. Roland runs it up and in. Earl Roland, by the way, St. Mary's Gael, 40 years old, still playing.
Incredible.
Yeah.
Incredible.
Yeah, good to see. Now that I'm in my late 30s, 37, I'm find myself rooting for the older guys.
Shoot, I'm in my early 30s, and I'm thinking the same thing. It's like, how do you even get out of bed in the mornings without creaking back? And man, that's impressive. Kudos.
Exactly. Risacher gets it up top. Driving on Moen Dadze. Contested three as the shot clock was winding down. Couldn't get past Moen Dadze. And the rebound there for Roanne. Oh, nice job by Risacher. I thought he might have tipped that off the fingertips of Moen Dadze, but does get the deflection.
Yeah, great job there from Risacher. No, I like that he's been a little bit more aggressive kind of in this garbage time period for Bourg en Bresse. Takes a three-pointer, his first of the game, kind of off the catch and shoot. There he creates his own shot off the dribble. Misses them both, but again, he does such a good job. It's like he's a little bit of a fish in that he has no memory. You know, he can completely wipe clean what just happened. He misses a shot that, you know, he's probably frustrated that he missed. Gets back in transition, gets a deflection on defense, and that's kind of a highlight of, you know, this is what he can bring to the table defensively because he covers so much ground and it does so quickly.
A foul. So I think that's Moulay Sow, who is listed as number 9 on their roster, but I believe that judging by the short length of his last name, top of the jersey number, I believe that is Moulay Sow at the line hitting the first free throw. He said he's like a goldfish, taking the Ted Lasso advice to heart, Risacher?
Yeah, no, actually, you know, as a father of young kids, I was actually leaning towards Dory. You know, just like complete memory wipe. Just has no recollection of what just happened. But can move on quickly. Yeah. So yeah, you can go that way. I'm more of a Finding Nemo guy.
I regret to inform you, I have not seen Finding Nemo.
Oh, this is shameful. Shameful to hear as we exit off this broadcast. should be rectified immediately. Great movie.
Well, that'll do it from Roanne. Bourg en Bresse, an impressive second half. They outscore Roanne 59-33 in the second half and win 111-87. Excuse me, 59-31. I mean, do my math correct. So a big second half from Bourg en Bresse. Zaccharie Risacher, who we came to see, 6 points in this game. Don't have all the stats for him. Unfortunately, the live stats page on the Pro A website was not working today, at least on my iPad, so we cannot pull up numbers. But your thoughts on what you saw from Risacher today, Kyle?
Yeah, he started slow. That was in part because he got into foul trouble in the first half. Sat for an extended period in the second quarter. Came back in the second half, and this Bourg en Bresse team just completely dominated in the second half. And, you know, that really wasn't in part because of what Risacher did. Defensively, he brought a lot of energy to the table. He had a lot of deflections on defense. Offensively, he was able to show some stuff, cutting to the basket, running in transition. Really impressed kind of with his energy and what he brought to the table. Missed two threes down the stretch of the fourth quarter there, but really, really good job, I thought, kind of sticking with it and staying engaged in this game.
Did you see anything today that changed your opinion one way or another on Risacher?
Not yet. Not yet. It's still super early on this 2024 class, but yeah. I mean, if you're picking near the top of the class, you have to be really excited. Obviously, we mentioned earlier in this broadcast, RC Buford from the Spurs is in attendance, and you know, so he probably wasn't treated to the best game, but overall, with what Risacher brings to the table, just at 6'8", the proposition of him as a 3-and-D type of player who could shoot the 3-point shot as a spot up shooter at a really high level, really good defensive versatility, and then hopefully he's going to be able to add some playmaking, some shot creation to his bag, and has at times flashed that this season. I really like what he's done in transition. He is a load to defend just because the athleticism that he brings to the table, and it's an exciting prospect to watch in this 2024 class.
Definitely is, as we're looking at some second half highlights. That was the three that capped off a 14-0 run for Bourg-en-Bresse to start the second half. There's Sekou Doumbouyahu. Kyle Boone believes, and I would not be surprised if he makes a return to the NBA one day.
Yeah, he had a great game, really, for the first half of this game for Roanne. Helped build out that halftime lead. Struggled a little bit in the second half, but shot the ball well in the first half, and that's kind of been his weak spot in terms of his game at the NBA level. Did a really good job of being aggressive on offense. It's a really good game for Doumbouya.
Maxime Corby on the three there. As you see, it was a 10-point game well into the fourth quarter, and Bourg-en-Bresse eventually won by 24. Jeremy Morgan, who had a really good all-around game, burying that three. And then in transition, the layup there for Maxime Corby to hit the century mark, which is not easy to do in the French League. Zaccharie Risacher, that was a nice move right there.
Yeah, it was. And that's what we talked a little bit about earlier, is his movement without the basketball. Did a really good job kind of finding an open spot in transition, getting an easy layup, and a really tough way to juggle it as well. Able to control it, bring it down, and go up for the easy layup. So did a nice job, I think, moving without the basketball today, showing some IQ, exactly what you want to see from Risacher.
All right, well, that will do it for us today. Again, final score, final time. Bourg-en-Bresse with a 111-87 win over Roanne. Big thank you to Kyle Boone of CBS Sports. That's where you can catch his mock drafts and all of his college basketball analysis. A big thank you to Harrison Preschel running the show behind the scenes for all those people and more. I'm Kevin Dana saying sayonara. We will talk to you Saturday on the NBA app for Cholet against Saint-Quentin. That'll be two French draft prospects, Melvin Agenca of Saint-Quentin going up against Tijan Salon of Cholet. So be sure to keep it locked right here on the NBA app for further French League action. Until then, we bid you adieu.